All right, everyone, thank you so much. I hope you enjoyed the food. I heard the lasagna was good. So, thank you so much for coming. We hope this is going to be an annual, or at least annual, if not more often, tradition where SCoSAA presents the work and the research of archivists in the field, the research that is relevant, of course, to us as pre-professionals, rising up through the profession and hopefully graduate.
So we have three panelists today. Probably most of you know Joel Blanco-Rivera, professor. We have Maggie McNeely from Brandeis University and Jordana
Ducani,
thank you, from Northeastern, who will be leading us off.
My name is Jordan Kani, and I'm the head of special collections and university archivist at Northeastern. I started my career at an organization called Associated Grantmakers, which is a philanthropic umbrella organization. AGM connects grantmaking organizations to each other, to communities, and emerging and relevant issues in the field. Here's the library. At AGM, I worked my way up from receptionist to running the Resource Center for Philanthropy, a library that taught mainly community-based nonprofit organizations effective nonprofit management, advocacy, fundraising, and grants research. And to nonprofits, the interaction with funders sometimes felt a little bit like this. And to funders, the interaction felt something like this. Even if both of the grant-making and the grant-seeking organizations were really set up to do something like form a school in Kenya. One of the things I learned that with successful organizations, all we seem to have an active, holistic outreach and advocacy program. It didn't matter if they were arts, community action, environment, or youth services. They communicated well with both their donors and their my community garden. These organizations identified potential donors, community members, stakeholders, and built relationships with them. They used their continuous effective communications to demonstrate their value, and they invited those interested players to become partners in their efforts. In this presentation, I'll talk about how advocacy can be applied to archives, and secondly, about how these principles have been applied to Northeastern to using the case study of a project involving the YMCA Career Cluster. When I started working in archives, I became increasingly surprised at how little time many archives, especially ones embedded into larger organizations or university structures, spent communicating their value. It was as if we just assumed that everyone knew how important our work was. We're one of a kind. We're preserving history. It's rare. So in the year before last, it was actually, I think it was 2 or 3 years ago at this point, I wrote a case study for a book on archival advocacy for the Society of American Archivists publications, describing my work with the Archives for Women in Medicine at the Kaplan Library, which is a job that I had previous to this one. The editor, Larry Hackman, has been a leader and a thinker in the advocacy arena for many years. And the book consists of case studies and analysis, including his own principles to consider, which I'll recap here briefly. So I don't want to even just spend a minute reading this. So, you know, shows that advocacy works. Reaching out, identifying stakeholders, demonstrating value, and creating partnerships are key to developing and sustaining a world-class archives. And in the next several slides, I will describe Northeastern's work using the example of the Y. I just love this photo. The Northeastern University Archives and Special Collections mission is twofold. The archives preserves historical records of Northeastern University's administrative and academic units, as well as those of selected individuals and outside organizations with ties to the university. It's a pretty standard university archives. Among its holding are university records and a wide variety of other materials, including the records of student organizations, campus publications, dissertations and theses, and the work of students on co-op, like this physical therapy student in 1983. So co-op, I don't know if you're familiar with it, but it's a hands-on learning opportunity that Northeastern was pretty much the pioneer of, where students work full-time embedded in an organizational structure. And so they, you know, doing some sort of job, we oftentimes have co-op in the archives from Northeastern where they learn hands-on. They do it in engineering, they work in companies, they do it internationally abroad, but it's the signature of Northeastern program. And they have cool haircuts. Special Collection houses and carefully curates a diverse and growing collection of historical records relating to Boston's fight for social justice. Our charge is to preserve the history of Boston's social movements, including civil and political rights, immigrant rights, homelessness, and then urban and environmental justice. We carefully maintain and care for the archives, like a normal archives does, climate control storage in our building, because we believe, and this is the most important part, that they are both important and useful and can form the basis of it in some incredible scholarship, both on campus and around the world. And more importantly, to Northeastern students having it in their curriculum, but also to the communities who donated them in the first place. A lot of these organizations are still around, and so having them be able to access their own archives is incredibly important, because a lot of these are community-based organizations that don't have any money to do this kind of work, because they're too busy running youth programs or, you know, whatever it is they do, or being a Mission Hill activist. So Northeastern University was established in 1898 as the Evening Institute for Young Men by the Boston YMCA. At night they taught auto mechanics, this is the Automobile Technical School, engineering and the law. In 1916, the school separated from the YMCA and became known as Northeastern College, and then 6 years later, it expanded to university. Since then, the Northeastern and the YMCA have stood side by side on Huntington Ave, working independently and collaborating to provide education opportunities for people to excel in their personal and professional lives. The Northeastern University Archives and Special Collections carefully curates and provides access to the records of both of these institutions, so the YMCA of Greater Boston, from founding all the way, and Northeastern, from founding all the way to the present. And this is where the tricky bit comes in. In 2011, a landmark agreement was made furthering the partnership between the YMCA and Northeastern, solidifying this relationship for the next 100 years, blah, blah, blah. This is a lot of, like, you know, PR speak, advocacy. And the agreement allowed for the Huntington Ave YMCA's aging gym, so all of these, like, it was built a very long time ago, and connecting structures to be raised, and the remaining buildings to be renovated in Northeastern to build a dormitory outside. So this, if you look at the Y on Huntington Ave, you see there's a giant dorm being built right in the back. So basically, the Y didn't reduce surfaces, they just stuck all of the gym structure closer to the main building. And in the next several slides, I'll describe the Northeastern University's work on this project. So what they did was they contracted, it was a historic structure. And so in order for the Massachusetts Landmarks Commission, the city to agree to have this gym, regardless of whether or not it was old and doesn't suit the purposes anymore, to have it raised, they needed to commemorate it historically. And so then they said, oh yes, everyone signed that agreement with no plan at all to actually do the work. And so they said, oh, well, you archivists, you can take care of this kind of thing. And so you know, we sort of hemmed and hawed in the library and said, well, you know, is this worthwhile to do? We knew we had the archives, so we needed to do something about it. But in the end, and I'll explain why, we decided to co-manage, or actually manage the project in its entirety. So we decided that the end product would be an historical exhibit and an architectural scale model permanently installed inside the WISE historic lobby. We approached faculty members to assist in creating the permanent exhibit with me. Architecture professor Lucy Malsby agreed to embed the YMCA project into the curriculum of her honors section of architecture and modernity in the city. Students researched the architectural history of various buildings on Huntington Ave, including visiting the archives to view the original Shepley architecture prints shown here from 1910. And one student remarked, I never knew how helpful looking at archival documents could be. Looking at the original building plans of the YMCA taught me more than I could imagine any book, which is a great quote to put on anything. Professor Victoria Kane agreed to focus her graduate course in issues and problems in public history entirely on the YMCA project. Students conducted research in the archives, scanned material. They actually did, we scanned it for them, but they provided the metadata and research topics, including its founding, relation to Northeastern, et cetera, et cetera. They found gems in the collection like this one, which I think is pretty fantastic, which was a whole era of like the businessman sports club. And they even conducted several oral histories using the library's media lab. That was from 1928. And we'll just watch this for a second. What happened? So this is Walter Fielding talking about how he, he's 96, and he used to go to the Y and play handball with his dad. If you really are interested, they're up on our digital repository, including Walter Fielding talking a little bit more about his playing handball with his dad. So, he's super cool. Over the course of the summer and the fall, so this is this past summer and this current fall, we hired one of the class's star pupils to distill the work and form the contents into a web-based exhibit. We hired a recent graduate of our of the design school at Northeastern to design the website's user interface. And arguably, this is the coolest part, was the architectural scale model. So we, in the archives, actually had the original, as I mentioned, the original 1910 plans of this historic building, and we had digitized them. And so this actually, that was a blueprint, but we made it not blue. And it was used by this student, William Fox, and he put them into a CAD software and put them on a plane. So, you know, this particular model, this particular drawing is this way, and this particular drawing is this way, and and because all of them were at scale, it was pretty easy to put them all together. And the library has a 3D printing studio, so based on the models that he designed, we actually printed them in our 3D printing studio. So we printed the exterior of the gym. Actually, this is the front of the YMCA. And then laser cut, the architecture student, laser cut the interior. So this is the actual stairwell. And this is the completed model. This is looking east down Huntington Ave. And one of the other plans was to show what the gym looked like on the inside. And so they also even put little laser cut people inside to show the scale model. And it's just a really interesting looking thing, worth spending the time to walk down Huntington Ave to look at the model. So, going back to the advocacy principles to consider that Larry Hackman so eloquently wrote about, you know, I took on this project, so this is my like little self-reflection part of it, because I have only been in this position for a couple of years, and before then there wasn't not something that we as archivists decided to do. This is something that the university decided to do, and we managed to fill the gap. We were working with the YMCA, one of our flagship collections, which solidified that relationship, which resulted into additional materials donated, and steps towards convincing others that the archives can have current use slash value at the university campus, and also we will be able to point to this permanent installation as something that other organizations could potentially do themselves, you know, based on historic buildings or archives, et cetera, et cetera. By the numbers, there was a budget attached to this project. Obviously, we wouldn't have been able to do this with no money. You know, it netted some significant money into the archives account, which paid for my grant-funded processor for about 6 months of work. Oral histories, we have them now inside, including Dr. Walter Fielding, and they live inside our digital repository. And we also administratively worked on processes in order to make oral history a part of the curriculum, which was something that had been done before. We had this media studio that no one had actually used for this purpose, so we created the standards for that. And we also managed to squeeze into the budget an outside vendor to scan 6,000 of our historical photographs, which, you know, from a preservation standpoint, you know, it's now that everybody's going to come and use the white collections all the time, having those scans maybe is going to be incredibly helpful in the future. And in the future, because this project literally just went up last month, we are planning on doing a lot of press about it and getting the Northeastern Archives name out there about it. We're planning on having like a behind the scenes, the making of the architectural exhibit, and doing it part of lots of different. We're hoping maybe we'll get a little, we'll see. But here it is. Something that the architecture people put together. There is sound for this too. So this is them putting the architecture plans on the plane. And, you know, and see how they actually go below the surface because it was built on pilings, because this is just at the edge of the back bay, and it was an infill. So here's the them pulling away the architectural plans and seeing how the laser cut stuff was put inside, and the skin was made. Recall there's a big thing on the top of it. It's not neon, but it's close. And what they did was they built the exterior, all of the surrounding buildings, as in a wood block, so that the model itself was emphasized. This is something that I would never come up with myself, but it was really pretty incredible that they were able to do it. So you have to look down Huntington Ave and see where the train goes underground from there. And this does have an inspirational soundtrack that goes along with it too. There's the gym, you know, which is no longer there, but it's all preserved. So that is the end of my presentation. Thank you very much.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Maggie McNeely. I work at the Brandeis University Archives and Special Collections. I'm the university archivist there, and I've been there for 9 years now. Starting out as an archives assistant at first, and then an assistant archivist, and et cetera. And to give you an idea of what I work on at Brandeis, because the title of the university archivist can be so different in different places, I just wanted to explain to you that I am a very much on-the-ground kind of university archivist, where I'm working on access to the collections. I do a lot of reference work. I work on acquisitions, also collection management and digitization projects, so really a lot of on-the-ground work. We do have a director of the department, so she does a lot of the management aspects of the department. Just a little bit about what I do for context. I'm happy to be here to talk about, I've picked up on the social justice aspect of the question about actually talk about it. I just thought I'd come up with a definition. I'm very interested to hear what you all think in the question and answer period about your own definitions and how that works. But for my presentation, I'm just going to say, for today, collections pertaining to social justice are collections dealing with issues of equality, justice, and diversity, and the efforts of people and organizations to achieve those goals. I offer up some examples of social justice collections at Brandeis. On the left, you'll see special collections in particular, and within that, you'll notice some names that'll give you some light bulbs about how they're relevant to social justice. On the right-hand side, you'll see a list of university archives, and you'll wonder what's going on here. And actually, most of these collections are collections that you'll see in any university archives, so you might wonder why I'm even talking about that. But one of the reasons is that those are the collections that I receive personally, and I'm talking to you. And two, I think it'll be clear why I think that they have a lot of relevance to this topic. Let's take a closer look at the University Archives collections. Some examples that I wanted to use. Within our faculty collections, we have a collection that includes the Ford Hall takeover, which in 1969 was an event where the Afro-American Student Organization took over a building on campus, issued about 10 demands of the university. They were there for 8 days. Questions and the demands had a lot to do with things like the hiring of more black professors, MLK scholarships, funding for programs that had to do with students of color, and also the formation of the Afro-American Studies Department. So this is a really important piece in our collection. Alumni collections, I give you the example of a SCoSAA diary. I don't know if any of you know about the SCoSAA program, but it was created by the Southern Christian Leadership Conference for students to travel south to get civil rights training and to go door to door and register Afro-American people to vote and actually to work the voting places as well. And I think Northeastern had some students as well that went south to do this. But we have a diary of one of our students who day to day wrote down all about the training, all about getting arrested and their window getting broken, and it's very dramatic and a really great resource. But that's an alumni collection, so it's not something you would think of immediately. Departmental records, we have records of the transitional year program at Brandeis, and this is a program that many universities have that are college prep programs for disadvantaged students. So students who are not quite ready for college, maybe they didn't have the means, or they weren't from a good school, or don't have a lot of support, maybe aren't ready for college, and Brandeis had the transitional year program. Actually, before that, they had Upward Bound as well. And this is a great collection. It's a very large collection and speaks a lot to students of color at Brandeis. And we also have the student activism collection, which many universities have. I'll just point out the civil rights file, which has one of my favorite items in it because it really helps illustrate Brandeis' unique history. It actually has a file about a protest that students held in 1961 that were In 1955, just 8 years after Brandeis opened its doors, the three chapels were constructed on its campus. Now Brandeis was founded, even though it was founded by the American Jewish community, it was founded as a non-sectarian university, so it was always meant to be a university for everyone. And these three chapels are really good at illustrating that. They were constructed for what were considered the three main religious communities at the time. So there's a Catholic chapel, there's a Protestant chapel, and there's a Jewish chapel. And they were constructed in such a way, very purposefully, to never cast a shadow on any of the other chapels. So this is all very purposeful. So in conclusion, here are my reasons for not collecting social justice materials at Brandeis. Essentially, if you're collecting materials at Brandeis, you would have no excuse, basically, in my situation. So moving on to the reasons in favor. And these are estimates that I have. From my personal experience, I would say that 90% of the classes that I lead involve subjects of equality, justice, and or diversity. So people are very interested in their own history of Brandeis, and particularly in these subjects. My examples are, there's an Afro-American Studies class that visits us every year about the history of race relations on campus. I was teaching them a couple hours ago today. They were very active, and it's a giant class for Brandeis, 28 students. Sociology every other year brings a class in to examine gender and sexuality. And history, we often get, I think once a year we get either focus on student activism in the 1950s or the 1960s. And I would also estimate that about 40% of the reference inquiries into the history of Brandeis are questions on some aspect of the same. I just included a couple of recent examples examining affirmative action at Brandeis, the issues of race and college admissions, and college prep for the disadvantaged, the TYP that I was talking about earlier. Just a quick note about some challenges. As far as collecting goes, obviously we just noticed that interest is not a problem here. Just a note about opportunity. I would say that I can't walk from one end of campus to another without seeing some opportunity to collect something having to do with social justice issues. It's a matter more of choosing the opportunities wisely, because you can't run around like a crazy person following every lead. So I would say that a real challenge would be to collect and represent multiple points of view and make sure that you have a fair representation of campus, because a lot of these issues are more complicated than whenever you kind of gloss over them in the newspaper. And there are a lot of people, different communities within, faculty members, that's great to get a full representation of the topic if you can. And that's definitely challenging. Format currently is definitely an issue for collecting, especially when we're talking about student groups, because as you know, students are more likely to do a lot of the planning for events these days on the web. So whether they're doing it through email or some sort of social media, a lot of their planning is done that way. So you won't get minutes of meetings. Maybe you'll get someone say, you know, do you want our email? We're planning this big event. And that's, as you know, a can of worms. So we have to investigate permissions if somebody's going to give us all the email, and we turn into a PDF and collect it that way, because we don't have yet a way to automatically do email yet at Brandeis. So format limitations are definitely real. As for access, again, interest, not a problem. As for fair representation, we have, I think, a lot of opportunities to teach about that, whether it's one-on-one with a student who's doing research or in the classroom. So, for example, with the class, the Afro-American Studies class that was in today, we teach about the Ford Hall takeover, and they examine the materials. I definitely make sure to pull representations of all different views on campus. The graduate students weren't a big fan of the takeover. So, you know, we pull that out and make sure that they realize that there are different communities and different parts of the story to try to get a fair representation of what happened during this time period. Undergrads also can always use a reminder that they need to examine as much of the material as possible in order to make any sort of generalization as to what happened. You know, I have a lot of students who come in from student newspapers who are interested in writing articles, and encouraging them to dig deeper and make sure that they have at least looked at a representation of the material. It's really helpful. I have a really weird item at the end here. professional. I need to know my community and the materials to be of service to them. So, for example, with student protests, depending on the decade, they might be represented differently in documentation. So, you know, me having been there for a little while and knowing the materials, I know that in the 1950s, they're not necessarily bringing protests to the campus. It might be in Boston. You know, they might be actually going out and, you know, going south with the freedom riders and other things like that. Whereas in the 60s, a lot of people brought their issues to campus and were doing a lot of activity on campus. So this changes the way that these things are documented. So that helps me as an information professional to figure out where to find this documentation. Care and curation is the second one that I have here. I think, again, as my role, the more I've been at Brandeis, the more I am reticent to interpret the materials for other people, even in exhibits, even on Facebook, whenever we post things. I think a lot of the material is self-evident, and to add our two cents about this is Brandeis doing its social justice thing is more irritating than not, so I try to stand back and let the material stand on its own. I also try to achieve balance in what I curate for the world to see. I know that social justice is very, very popular, but I don't want our department Facebook page to come across as biased or political, so I also make sure I balance the social justice material with the general interest material as well. We have a really interesting new issue come up. We do have our most popular student newspaper digitized and online. I recently had an offer for a student who wrote for a conservative newspaper, which as you can imagine is kind of a minority community at Brandeis, and he offered to digitize it. And it's a really interesting question because when I put that side by side with the main newspaper, there are lots of other newspapers, you know, that are not this, you know, this secondary newspaper. It's a pretty minor paper. But it's interesting because it makes us think about representation online, and are we going to be able to have people understand, you know, how large these communities are, or who communities these represent. So it's such a big question. I haven't yet, you know, come up with a solution. I'm definitely going to take up the offer to get digitized on his dime, and we'll definitely put it up. But it brings up an interesting subject. Targeting collections work based on interest, based on high interest, we're able to justify more care and processing, more collecting attempts, more digitization. This is the high-demand material, and that's well-known in the university, so we really don't have to justify that, so that's really great. Appealing to the community for materials. Brandeis does not have much of a purchasing budget for archives and special collections, so I do almost all my collecting through the Brandeis community, which makes sense to do anyway. And I just wanted to mention a couple successful collecting efforts. Actually, in our digital age, I've had a lot of success with doing old-fashioned print advertising in the alumni newsletter. It's actually how I got the SCoSAA diary, because I placed an ad, a nice big ad with a photo asking people if they have materials relating to what happened on campus following the assassination of Martin Luther King Jr., because we don't have a lot of documentation as to what happened. I know there were memorial services, so I posted that, and a woman contacted me, and she said, I don't know if you're interested, but, and you'll be surprised at a university or a college what interesting things your alumni have and how little they value it when it comes to other people. So she wasn't even sure that we would want the SCoSAA diary, which to me is kind of a crazy idea, but it's true. It's how people feel. They feel like it's my diary, I wrote it, and no one else is interested. So even in a very old-fashioned way, like putting it out there in the magazine, which I know that they read, actually resulted in a really great collection. Also, I did a project where I was just being open to how my resource could help the archives. This is the Intercultural Center, and she was very disorganized. She didn't have a lot of history material. She wasn't willing to let anything go because she wanted to keep everything there. And I walked into the office and I noticed two things. First of all, she puts them in collages on the wall, all the historic materials, and she had a history binder. And, you know, she just wasn't willing to part with it, so I brought a scanner in there, you know, took down the collages, took them apart, scanned everything, put it up, and put it back together, and she has her materials, but, you know, I felt like the materials were so important, and people are already using it, and people want to
assuming that various groups on campus or people would not have social justice related material. I was speaking with a French professor the other day, and he said, by the way, there's a document about me trying to help found the ICC and to recommend how to make students of color comfortable on campus in 1988. So just never know who it might come from. I also did an interview with a couple, an alumni couple, who the development office wanted me to interview them. So they're obviously people of means and people who are, you know, a privileged background. They're donors to Brandeis. Obviously, the development office was interested and said, please interview these people. But that's why they were doing that. But it's interesting, at the very end, I asked them if they had any extra questions or extra things to talk about, and they said that they were very happy about their experience at Brandeis because a lot of their students didn't have the money to go to college, and they were given the opportunity by Brandeis, and they probably would have otherwise gone to college because Brandeis offered really, really generous scholarships in the community. So you never know who's going to have some information about one of these topics. And lastly, I would say just a lesson I learned a couple hours ago, be open to criticism on how these collections are handled. The Fort Hall class today, a student asked me why the Fort Hall takeover materials were located in the collection of a faculty member who was an older white man. And she said, you know, why this? I know this guy wasn't directly involved in Fort Hall. Why is the collection under his name? And doesn't that imply that he is somehow responsible for the Fort Hall takeover? And I was just really kind of taken aback, and I just couldn't just say, well, it's provenance. You know, he actually found the material and he turned the material in and it was in his possession for a little while. But, you know, I really feel like now I have to do something about this, because to future generations, sometimes we lose sight of the fact that, you know, there are implications and where this collection lives, and that people in the future will start to think that in some way he's responsible. If they don't know him personally, they don't have the experience of knowing, oh, that guy would never take credit for, you know, what happened in 1969. Because he was there. He was a minor professor at that time. But I don't know, it's really interesting to me how this provenance question came up, because sometimes I think we can get so involved in, you know, doing what we think is the right thing to do, but when you think about how people are experiencing collections and how this information comes across, it can be a whole other story. And I just mentioned at the end, supporting the diversity statement on my work as much as possible is also something I try to do. I had a couple examples of that in there as well.
So, good evening. So what I will be talking is mainly two of my points, and in some way follows on the terms that I presented at the beginning in terms of the concept of social justice itself, what it means in terms of archivists and the impact on archives. So it's not just going to define social justice, but I will be presenting, there was an article that was published last year, kind of a preliminary research by archivists and professors, Wendy Duff, Andrew Flynn, Karen Swoopman, and David Wallace, when they started kind of thinking about the concept of social justice and trying to not just define social justice in the context of archives, but also trying to develop frameworks to better understand the relationship between archives and social justice. So I'll talk briefly about that. And I will connect one of those frameworks that they present in their article to a case study which I did as part of my dissertation work when I was in Pittsburgh, which is looking at a case study of the work of the National Security Archive in Latin America. So if any of you took part in or took 438 with me, don't worry, there's some information. I'm repeating what I say in the classroom, so don't worry about that. So that's kind of the two main aspects of thinking about in terms of this presentation. So in the essay that is titled Social Justice Impact of Archives, a Preliminary Investigation, the authors presents the first step towards a more concrete conceptualization of the relationship between social justice and archives. This publication is the first page of a research project whose goal is to assess and understand more clearly the impact of archives on social justice efforts. Because of the increasing appearance of the term social justice, discuss this, not just in the literature, but also in projects and practice and different initiatives from the profession. The author seems that it's important to analyze and consider what archivists really mean by social justice, and how could archivists explore the social justice impact of archives. So the authors do not intend to just provide a definition, but rather to develop frameworks that could provide a better representation of the archival impacts on social justice. So one of the important things from the article, which is the quote you see here, is that they underscore the power is fundamental consideration for the understanding of the concept of social justice and its relation to archives. So they say, quote, first and foremost, place power and its distribution from a center as the most significant consideration for understanding social justice and injustice. The art that archives can both produce and reproduce justice and injustice in the decisions they make and on how they shape the past and engage the present. So in the context of human rights, archivists stress issues of power in relation to access, accountability, collective memory, among other themes. The scholarship mostly assess the power of archives used both as an instrument of repression and control and as a tool for claiming victims' rights. Similar to the above consideration of the concept of power, the authors also explain that the impacts of social justice are complex and multidimensional. In countries under transition from a repressive past, which will be the focus of my presentation, particularly in Latin America, these complexities are demonstrated by the fact that unresolved matters continue long after the beginning of the transition. So, for instance, after more than 15 years, human rights trials continue in Latin American countries like Argentina, Chile, Guatemala. In Brazil, President Dilma Rousseff signed a law in 2011 creating a truth commission that will investigate human rights violations committed in the country between 1945 and 1988. And in Chile, it was not until 2010, 20 years after the beginning of the political transition, that the Museum of Memory and Human Rights opened its doors. So as a proposal to study the archive social justice relationship, the authors present a framework that illustrates the role archives might play in social justice issues. This framework is represented through a multi-directional process with the following three steps. Recognition of systemic inequalities, employment of intellectual and physical resources to challenge these inequalities, and impacts of systemic systemic inequalities. The concept of systemic inequality, as they define it, is the following definition, quote, how individuals, group, organizations, and communities are excluded from important decisions and processes affecting them and society. So this framework, I look at this framework and explore it, applying the work of the National Security Archive in Latin America, particularly the work dealing with human rights issues, in terms of the use of records in different processes with political transitions in Latin America. I will provide some context about that. So in the context of this case study of looking at the National Security Archives and the work in human rights issues in Latin America, systemic inequalities refers to the state's systemic violations of human rights. So applying this framework to the work of the National Security Archives, archive underscores three roles in which the archive impact transitional justice. First and foremost is the role as of the National Security Archive as a repository of declassified U.S. government records, which opened the door for the identification and use of records as evidence of past human rights violations. Members of two commissions, for example, among others, use records housed at the archives for their respective investigations. The second goal is the involvement of members of the National Security Archive in specific transitional justice mechanisms. For example, this includes some members of the National Security Archives being expert witnesses in human rights trials in different countries in Latin America. And finally, the National Security Archive has collaborated with networks of human rights groups in Latin America. So taking together these three roles illustrates archives' contribution to human rights advocacy. So let's look at each of these three steps or phases within this relationship of archives So as I mentioned before, social justice is complex and multidimensional. This includes the recognition that inequalities go beyond economic marginalization. As the authors of the article explain, in the context of justice, the social justice, the definition of systemic inequalities is looking at how individuals, groups, organizations, and communities are excluded from important decisions and processes affecting them of society. The authors explain that social justice also applies to structures of non-recognition and marginalization. So these structures of non-recognition are exposed in authoritarian regimes, which most of the countries in Latin America experienced during the Cold War. During this dark period in the history of the region, military dictatorships marginalized individuals and groups that presented dissenting voices and actions against the regime. Dictatorship excluded communities from processes affecting society, and they did so with systemic actions of terror, illegal detentions, torture, murders, and forced disappearances. The non-recognition by the regimes of the rights of freedom of speech, for example, right to dissent, among others, turned into a systemic inequality during the regime. This in turn created an environment in which the state acted with impunity. The struggle against this impunity has continued decades after the end of this transitional regime, as some of the examples that I mentioned earlier. So in that context, in the political transitions that began in the 1980s, mostly within the 1990s in Latin America, comes this concept of transitional justice, which is basically how societies and how countries address the legacy of past human rights violations during periods of trauma. So the type of mechanisms that are used and implemented for addressing this legacy includes truth commissions, human rights trials, and reparations. To give you some context in terms of Latin America, from 1983 to 2003, there were 12 truth commissions that were created in Latin American countries. In addition, and predominantly since the late 1990s, hundreds of trials have been taking place, both international trials and also national trials. And still today, the trials go on in various countries. While the creation of transitional justice mechanisms can be considered an acceptance of systemic inequalities, their implementation requires the employment of resources to challenge these inequalities. But this includes access and use of archives. In Latin America's transition, the National Security Archive became part of both the intellectual and physical resources employed to challenge the inequality of the repressive past. To give you some background about the National Security Archive, actually the foundation of the National Security Archive has Latin American links. Its origins can be traced back to 1984 with the Central American Project, an effort by journalist Raymond Bonner and then House Representative Jim Booty to gather declassified civil government records about the foreign policy in Central America. Looking to move beyond the Central American Project, Scott Armstrong, a former Washington Post journalist, along with other journalists and scholars, founded the National Security Archive initially in 1985. During my research, I was able to interview some members of the archives. One of them was Kate Doyle, who is the senior analyst at the National Security Archives. And she explains that the interest from members of the archives to study US policy towards Latin America, along with the convergence of the early years of the archives and the end of the Cold War, led them to get involved with investigations of human rights violations in the region. She underscored that while the National Security Archive was founded as a research institution and an advocacy organization, the role expanded for those who focus in Latin America, looking more into the focus of human rights. So this work towards uncovering a repressive past through US government records is illustrated by the three main roles that the National Security Archives played in Latin America. As I mentioned earlier, the archive as a repository of US government records, US government declassified records, the participation of members of the archives in human rights trials, and the archives collaboration with human rights organizations. So the National Security Archive has obtained tens of thousands of declassified records about US policy in Latin America during the Cold War particularly. These collections include special collections about Cuba, Guatemala, El Salvador, which was the first collection that they acquired, Chile, basically most of the countries in Latin America. Most of these documents that made these collections were obtained through numerous Freedom of Information requests, so using actually the Freedom of Information Act to acquire those documents. Declassified records that are housed in the National Security Archive has been used by two commissions as part of their investigations, and sometimes it was really important because they serve as documents that they were able to use when they found like blocks to access military records in the countries they were investigating. And also there have been declassified records that have been presented as evidence in trials that have been successful in terms of prosecuting perpetrators of human rights violations. So in addition to assisting to two commissions, the National Security Archive have also provided declassified documents to criminal cases and lawsuits in, for example, Mexico, Guatemala, Chile, Peru, Argentina, and Spain. Furthermore, members of the archive has been expert witnesses in a number of human rights trials. So at the left, the picture is Kate Doyle when she was testifying on declassified records in the trial against former Peruvian president Alberto Fujimori in 2007, who was found guilty of human rights violations and sentenced to 25 years in prison. On the right, there was one of the multiple cases, criminal trial that have been going on in Argentina, where Carlos Osorio, who is also a senior analyst at the National Security Archive, also presented expert testimony on declassified records about Argentina and particular cases. And mostly the cases that I see in terms of what was the impact of the role of those records that were presented was mostly, well, they were not like smoking guns, but this is the evidence that proved that the person that was, you know, but actually it provided us kind of a context and big picture about the political situation that was going on at the moment, and also kind of the role of government, both the government of the country, but even in terms of the relationship with the US foreign policy. So it's looking more at the context, important of the context to understand that the criminal acts that were tried in these human rights trials were not just isolated cases, but it was evidence that there was a systemic process of human rights violations by the states. Then the third goal is the collaboration with human rights organizations. It was really fundamental for the members of the National Security Archive that have been working in Latin America. And actually, people that study and practice in terms of transitional justice mechanisms like two commissions, like human rights trials, they underscore that human rights organizations and social movements have been really fundamental for the instances in which those mechanisms have been implemented. So one of the main factors are those groups in terms of the impact of accountability for human rights abuses in Latin America. So because of the importance of U.S. declassified documents, the National Security Archives collaborated with networks of human rights organizations in the region. Actually, it could be argued that this involvement of the archives with human rights groups or the Latin American would not have been possible without the organization's relationship with these human rights groups. And one of the things that I want to underscore from here, actually, I want to read a quote from Kate Doyle when I interviewed her about this, in this particular topic, about their relationship and networking with human rights organizations. So this is what Kate told me in the interview. So quote, I got involved in bringing documents as an expert into these trials because of the network of amazing human rights organizations that works on these trials and with which we work. I think the reason it works, the way this role of the archive has evolved, is because it has come organically out of our collaborative work with human rights organizations over the many, many years. So this engagement exemplifies the significance of accountability and advocacy in the archival mission. Groups Six Records vote for immediate purposes of holding particular perpetrators accountable for human rights violations, and for the long-term purpose of continuing dissemination of memories of the traumatic past. This in turn impacts advocacy efforts toward the right to know, and therefore the right to access government records. Finally, thinking about the impact on systemic inequalities, as, and learning process. Again, as is highlighted in the essay, the complexities of understanding the impact of archival approaches to social justice should not be just based on tangible outcomes. They're both tangible and intangible outcomes. So in terms of tangible outcomes, you can easily think about, as part of those impact, the successful trials in which perpetrators were found guilty for their crimes, so in terms of accountability, different initiatives done by the Voice from Truth and Reconciliation Commissions, for example. Similarly, the access to the classified government, U.S. government documents from the National Security Archive has impacted the study of the history of violence during the periods of authoritarianism in Latin America and the active role of the U.S. administrations. In terms of the intangible impacts of the declassified documents, can be found in personal stories of people whose loved ones were victims of repression. So for example, in Latin America, this was particularly the case of the disappeared, or the desaparecidos. With the absence of a desaparecido, relatives encounter an emotional connection to archival records. This is illustrated in one example that I want to present to close the presentation. In the experience of Sabrina Valenzuela Negro from Argentina. Sabrina's parents were kidnapped in Argentina on January 2nd, 1978, along with Raquel's, her brother, Sebastián. Raquel Negro was the mother of Sabrina, gave birth to a girl and a boy, and then was disappeared. Her daughter, who was Sabrina Valenzuela, was left at a convent and given for adoption. In 2008, the DNA test confirmed that she was the daughter of Raquel Negro. On August 2009, a federal court tribunal in Rosario, Argentina, began a trial against members of the intelligence unit 121 of Rosario and accused for human rights violations against 28 individuals. Two of those individuals that were disappeared were the parents of Sabrina and Sebastián. Carlos Osorio provided expert testimony on the declassified records of Argentina in terms of the authenticity of the records and the context of the records. And Sabrina also was a witness in the trial. That opportunity, opportunity for Carlos Osorio from the National Security Archives to go to this trial and be an expert testimony was also an opportunity for him to meet Sabrina, to meet Sebastián. So on December of 2009, he published a blog post in the blog from the National Security Archives, which is a moving account of his experience in the trial and his experience meeting Sabrina and Sebastián. So during a meeting at a hotel lobby with Sebastián, with Sabrina, and her uncle, he showed them 21 documents, many of which mentions her father, Tulio Valenzuela, and all documents also mention Raquel, who was the mother. Upon looking at the documents, this is what Osorio recalls in his blog post, Sabrina expressed the following, quote, "It is as though the documents enable us to touch them." That's just one example of looking at the intangible process of connecting archives and records with personal. So I think in my context, not just in terms of from the context of the present regimes in terms of the creation of records, but even again, I mentioned briefly, for example, the instances for when two commissions were trying to get access to military archives and they were denied access to those archives. And it was not archivists that were denying the access, it was the military itself, or even they were just claiming that those records did not exist. And that's not the case. So that would be one example top of my head of thinking about how records are able to use against, justice. That project, that would be one example of what you think of.
I think that it's really easy to, out of a hope to protect the
two examples.
One is like a testimonial to how oftentimes what happens over time is, I mean, you're the expert in this, Jeanette, is that memories get crystallized and people either get put into like good category or evil category, and that's just never the case. I mean, because people are complex and history is complex, and you know. So, for example, in Boston, there was a member of the school committee called Louise Day Hicks, and she was an elected member. And in the narrative around her, in the current narrative around her, is that she was racist because she was anti-school desegregation via busing. And as it turns out, you know, there's nothing in the archives to say this, but that she was actually doing a lot of social justice activity in backdoor ways. Like she was paying for windows to be put into the La Alianza Hispana building in Mission Hill. So I mean, I think that I think it's important for us to emphasize the complexity of, you know, like what is justice and what is not necessarily justice, and vilifying people versus sanctifying people, and all of that messiness that comes when you're looking at historical documents, and because nothing is wrong. The other thing is that from a like, you know, life and death standpoint, I worked at the Harvard Medical School Archives, where we are collecting scientists working on the reduction of, working on AIDS from a science perspective. And in their collections, there were a lot of, you know, AIDS Action and ACT UP organizations like throwing blood at them at scientific conferences, like pig's blood, because the drugs were not coming to, people were dying, a lot of people were dying, and drugs were not coming fast enough, and the trials were too small. And so there were, you know, I mean, and so there were, these scientists were holding on to this information based on like their need to go through the scientific method and to go through clinical trials. And then moving over to Northeastern, where we're actively collecting the science and care, the care of AIDS, and you know, the gay community's reaction to this. And these are the people throwing blood on the scientists. And so it's just a really interesting sort of like, you need to look at both perspectives in order to, I mean, as a researcher, you need to look at those perspectives in order to like have a true understanding.
Not most people, not. I would say a few exceptions. The focus is on the records that they obtained from the U.S. government.
Okay.
After classification, they also get like journalists that decide to donate their materials, like particularly their declassified records that they use for any investigation. They, you know, they will donate that collection to the archive. They have been, I think in terms of the records, it's mostly actually, and there's something I didn't touch in the presentation, is actually more a collaboration with archives in Latin America, like the police archives in Guatemala. They have been involved in that since the early, you know, early after it was discovered, with the Archive of Terror in Paraguay, in terms of providing technical assistance, in terms of collaborating. So not collecting those documents, but actually kind of assisting. In the management of those archives in different ways. Mm-hmm. I think in that in particularly, for example, in the particular those archives that haven't read anything recently in terms of any involvement they have been involved, again, in terms of helping with legal cases, like the massacre of the priest in 1989, there were some legal cases, and they have records, declassified records at the archive from the first collection that, you know, that they built with the archive. So their focus has been on that. So in those particular instances, I mean, I'm sure there's kind of advocacy involved in that in terms of providing that kind of support, but how direct is that with, for example, this example of diocese, I don't know. So I think two things are important. Is one of them is as a non-governmental organization, so they're not part of the government, they even as a policy, they don't get any public funding for any project, so they're not there as a policy. And as the initial way of, it was created by the journalists that have been involved in reporting, some of them reporting on the ground what was going on in Central America, for example, in the 1980s. So that creates, in terms of, and then, on the other hand, like those journalists were very critical, people back then, of the government policies towards Latin America. So that's this critical voice on that. So actually, they see themselves as both a research institute to have a collection and also an advocate for open government and access and transparency. So that's kind of the role that they go through. I think the way I see it is that, again, and something that Kate Doyle mentioned to me in terms of how they build this relationship is because of part of those processes of investigation, yeah, there's a recognition by the, clearly by the members of the National Security Archive and by organizations in Latin America of the direct role of the United States government in financial training and everything. So there are a lot of records from the US government that kind of document all that. And those are records that are important to look at and to access. So they serve like this bridge between secret archives that the government maybe doesn't want to show, but actually as part of the constant like pressuring, using FOIA and using public pressure to get documents released, that was a clear element in terms of building that trust the organizations have to have.
Just to repeat a little bit, so I was interested in the mention, and one slide I had a mention of the SCoSAA and the Zeti collections, are actually five of them. It's not a single collection, but there are five discrete collections where people collect information on SCoSAA and Zeti, and also the Dreyfus trial. I would say that those are a result of a lot of really early support at Brandeis that we received. There was an organization called the Brandeis Bibliophiles, Files, and there was a lot of passion in building Brandeis. I think that a lot of people who had collections were interested in helping the university along by donating their collections. So these aren't collections that I oversee, so I think what's true about the SCoSAA and Zeti, some people who were, their family members were involved in the trial and that sort of thing. But I think that there's always been kind of this assumption,
I don't remember his last name. There's an article. One of my favorite quotes in kind of looking at the literature about social justice and kind of looking at the extremes. He was about a case study who from Norway dealing with children that were not recognized because one of their parents were from Nazi Germany. So it was something like that. There was a legislation that kind of required them to prove so they can be recognized, and that involved going to archives and looking for documents and all this. But the reason I'm bringing that is like one of the quotes in that article is like basically says, paraphrasing, archivists just need to be archivists. Our goal is to, in fairness and provide access to documents. And we're not judging, we provide access to our policies. So even in those extreme circumstances, it was just simple putting that in the sentence in the paragraph. I think it's just need to be archives. We are not to impose justice like all the responsibility, but we can be part of the process and do all the responsibility. So that's the way I would paint it.
I definitely agree when it comes to
try to, you know, represent what I think that they want. And I think that that's where we run into the issue of, you know, really affecting the collection and really affecting how people see history is when you're actually selecting the materials, which, you know, you have to be really cognizant of. But I think when I, as far as, you know, roles, I like the, you know, classic trying to be as unbiased as possible, presenting the material. Recently I put something on our Facebook page that was a 1957 reflection on Brandeis students. It was someone from the South, and they were a reporter, and they were talking about their impressions of Brandeis students and how they didn't respect Southern rights and that they were really just interested in integration at all costs. And, you know, so it was a really interesting piece because it was somebody else's reflection. And I think when I first started out, I would have, you know, maybe wrote on the page, you know, social justice in 1957. But I really think that, you know, these things speak for themselves and that we don't need to add our commentary so much to them. You know, certainly presenting it is really important, and it's definitely important to the university, especially, you know, university, the one I work for, associates itself so strongly. But I think that it depends on who you're talking to. Like, I think the administration and the faculty, you know, I think playing up the fact that we have these collections to talk about the Brandeis mission over the years is helpful. But students, I kind of stand back a little bit because I think that they can do it on their own. I think they, you know, take it very seriously and they want to investigate themselves and want to come up with, you know, is it just, you know, official talk that we're all about social justice or is it real? So I like to let them explore that on their own.
I have lots of unformulated thoughts about this. I don't know if it's simple. I think it's a case-by-case basis. I think, and it really depends on the culture of the parent organization that you're working for, too. So, you know, in our case, Northeastern is very careful about its branding at the moment. And there have been some controversial things that have ended up in the media based on people not necessarily being inclusive as the university wants to portray itself as being in the 1950s, but who was inclusive in the 1950s. And I think that that's, so in some ways, like, you know, it's tough as an archivist because, you know, they want, there is a reaction from upper echelon to expunge, to sanitize history and make it a lot more rosy than it actually was, and, you know, if you were living through the time, in any time, not all of it was necessarily very rosy. So that's one thing. I think, you know, we have a lot of oral history projects and various collections that have lots of controversial things in them, some of which are a product of their own particular time, and some of which are just controversial because the ideas contained within the documents are controversial. So yeah, I mean, in some ways, like, I would never reduce access to that kind of material, but I think that saying something like, well, Archie Bunker was from the 50s, you know, like, there was a lot of people that had very opinionated ideas about race at this particular time, sets a kind of context that somebody who doesn't really know very much about time periods could think of. So it's not an advocacy sort of, it's more like making sure that people don't necessarily try to emphasize the complexity of time periods of people and of that kind of thing in order to avoid the knee-jerk reaction.
My example, I think, was mentioned actually for my appraisal class this morning. I went to UMass Boston to interview university archivist John Riley and public historian Caroline Goldstein. And they, one of the initiatives they have is the Mass Memories Workshop, and it's a participatory public history project where people from a print their own photographs, and they also can do all the histories and all the process. And that's one approach of documentation, of collecting information or disseminating information that comes from a participatory approach, post-custodial, if you know, using those terms. And at the same time, they also, in the archive, they have the traditional responsibilities of acquisitions, and they're still connected with their mission. So they're looking at different roles and different ways of doing that documentation. And even collecting the records that are created as part of those events are archival records that are important. So that's one example that I can think of in terms of trying to use different ways of documenting communities that can even go beyond just thinking the very traditional archival principles and practices. So it can be done both ways, yeah.
We're set up to document diversity. I mean, that's our special collection this focus. But I think, you know, one of the things, for example, early on in my career, I worked in the Schlesinger Library, which is the Women's History Library of Berkeley. Bradley, you worked there? Okay. So when I was there, there was a really significant movement to collect conservative sides of issues like Phyllis Schlafly, records of the National Organization for Women. And they couldn't, you know, so because everybody knew, all of these conservative women thought about this archive as an extension of the movement, of the feminist movement. And so they just had zero luck getting these conservative organizations. So that was their attempt at diversity, is to include these conservative women. And it just, they couldn't make it happen. So I think, you know, and so in some ways, like at Northeastern, part of our challenge is this sort of, you know, movement of the university into a different realm, which is to say that from the 50s through the 70s, Northeastern was a commuter school, basically like UMass Boston. And what they did was they were, you know, taught engineering classes, and if you graduated, you basically had a ticket to it was hard to graduate, but this is what they, that's the kind of purpose that they function as, and that's not the case anymore. So, you know, the Tao Yao issues surrounding the university and its campus and Lower Roxbury is not necessarily, you know, can be contentious at some points, and so sometimes collecting in various communities, like, oh, Northeastern. So I think that it's not, I think that it's, that's an element for consideration. I love the Mass Memories Roadshow. I think they're great. But even that can be contentious too. So for example, they recently on Saturday, this past Saturday, if you go to one of the roadshows, please do, it's awesome.
I went to the one?
I wasn't able to go at the West End.
Yeah, West End.
So the West End was a neighborhood in Boston that was completely razed during urban redevelopment. Completely, the whole neighborhood was gone. And they put up these giant high rises, and it was called Progress. But the people that used to live in this neighborhood was like this melting pot of ethnic communities and these close, you know, quasi-tenement housings. You know, there are very large Jewish population, Poles were there, I don't even remember who else was there, some Italians. Mm-hmm. And it was a very working class community, and then it wasn't. And some people describe this as like they went away to summer camp, where the West End house, you know, used to take all the kids to summer camp. And they came back and they were living in a different place. So, I mean, it was a very dramatic shift. So what Joanne at UMass, they had people from the beginning, so from when it was a neighborhood of small places to, and then also people who moved into these high-rises and had been there for 4 years. So it was like this really interesting